Machine, but if you insist. Okay, can you hear me? Yes. Right. Well, thanks a lot, Randall, for asking me to come and talk about this, which is really part of my work that interests me more at the moment. I am an observational astronomer who has come to know about charge exchange relatively recently. And now I see the whole relevance of it to astrophysics as well as to geophysics. And I will be talking about the work done by many people that have studied X-rays produced by charge exchange in the solar system. And in this context, Chandra and XMM have really demonstrated and brought to visibility charge exchange as one of the very important processes that we have to consider. Now, this is a summary of my talk. I'll focus on Jupiter and charge exchange at Jupiter with a bit of past, present, and future observations, and concentrate on the main question of where do the precipitating particles, the ions that do charge exchange, come from. There is no charge exchange at Saturn, as far as we can see so far, so why not? We'll have a look at that. I can't stop myself from showing Mars spectrum. You have seen a glimpse already from Conrad. That's all work by Conrad, and it's really a remarkable thing in terms of charge exchange. And then I want to talk about exploiting charge exchange at our own planet, and in practice turning it from an unwanted X-ray background, as we have seen yesterday, to a diagnostic for the magnetosphere, which we have already heard something about yesterday. But going back in time, now charge exchange has come to the fore recently, say in the last 10 years or so, but on the other hand, has been thought as being at the back of the production of X-rays long, long ago. In fact, well, the Jupiter was first detected by the Einstein Observatory IPC barely in 1979, and then confirmed the detection with the HRI. And you see, in the HRI already, you can separate the two aurorae, and this was 1981. And Metzger, that made this observation, already noticed that assuming Bremsstrahlung as the origin of the X-rays didn't work, and one would take Bremsstrahlung because the Earth was already known to produce X-rays in the aurora by Bremsstrahlung, but on Jupiter it doesn't work because the spectrum or the emission is too soft and too bright to be explained by electrons slowing down. And so already then the suggestion that there may be heavy ion precipitation involved and charge transfer was proposed by and modeled carefully by Orani, Craven, Swaite. But at the time they only used low charge ions and speculated that if those ions were accelerated could actually make up that emission. Then came Rosat, and again the emission from Jupiter was confirmed, and confirmed in terms of line emission, because then the spectrum was a bit better than with the IPC. And again, electron capture, the excitation was used as the explanation. And then it was Cravens in 1995, which really modeled the charge transfer using the highest charge states of the ions and established that the X-ray emission had to come from that charge exchange process. And also predicted, modeled the spectrum, providing examples that fitted well the Rosat data. Now, what I show here is more a curiosity than anything else, but there was an observation of Jupiter with the HRI in 94 at the time of the Shoemaker-Levy 9 impact on the planet, and it actually showed the aurora, with Rosat again, brightening up right at the time of these two particular impacts of the fragments from the comet. Now, the question is still open of what caused those enhancements. maybe the impacts actually produced a reaction in the general planet situation to have energization of the aurora. Or maybe some of the fragments on the dust actually managed to reach the poles. But that's quite a curious observation. Anyway, the present, as you know, is Chandra and XMM Newton, still very bright. And when I talk about the future, really what I'm thinking about is of Athena, very long down the line, with a launch in 2028. But that will give us the top quality spectra and images that we can get with extremely high sensitivity. And in particular, this integral field unit, a calorimeter like AstroH will carry, but with some hopefully 2 square meters of effective area, will be the workhorse for solar system observations. Anyway, going back to Chandra in particular, by the time Chandra flew in 1999, already so the ionic CX process was thought as the basis of the emission, you know, on Jupiter. But yet the first observation that Chandra made already brought in very startling results. And one was that until then, the ions were probably originating in the inner magnetosphere, or something like between 8 and 12 Jupiter radii distance from the planet. That's where Io, the satellite Io, is at 6 RJ, and the Io plasma torus, and that's a region with lots and lots of tons of material emitted by the volcano on Io. So that's a great suggestion. Seems obvious that material would come from there and then precipitate on the poles and produce charge exchange. But in actual fact, the Chandra data show that this hot spot of soft X-rays is actually concentrated within this UV oval, which corresponds to this inner magnetosphere distance. So that means, if you think of the magnetic field lines going outwards from the planet, that the particles producing these come from much further out from the planet, so something like 30 RJ or more. So the question is, and it still was then, and it still is, to a certain level, what are the species of these ions, and that means where are they really coming from? And in practice, there are 2 possibilities. One is the magnetosphere, but then the species should be mostly oxygen and sulfur, because that's what comes out of the volcano on Io. If it is solar wind instead, precipitating down along these open magnetic field lines, then you would expect the ions and then the lines that we observe to be of carbon. The problem is that because carbon is abundant as a minor ion in the solar wind. And the problem is that carbon and sulfur lines are quite close together, 0.3, 0.4 of a kV. And at the resolution of CCDs, you can't really distinguish them. So, cutting a very long story short, it seems that XMM Newton, Chandra, and Chandra spectra tend to suggest that the origin is magnetospheric. I prefer to keep an open mind because of what I'm going to say in a minute, but I think that there may be a case for relative roles of these 2 processes, and it would be interesting to see when in particular these processes take place, so when the origin is pinned down. Now, another interesting result from Chandra was that emission from the hot spot is actually pulsating. Very strong pulsation. You can see them in the light curve, a strong periodogram peak at 45 minutes. And that has not been explained really yet. This is a unique observation in the sense that has never been seen so strongly, this pulsation again. But similar periodicity have been seen later on of the order of tens of minutes or so, sometimes not strictly periodic. But that may be a clue, actually, to the origin of these ions again. Anyway, having such higher quality data like the Chandra, then detailed modeling of the spectra and of the precipitating particles and so on was carried out all through these years. And yesterday you have seen already a very good review of all of this work by David Schultz. Anyway, I pick out two papers that are quite relevant to what I'm considering. One is Cravens in 2003, and they calculated essentially the field-aligned potentials that are necessary to boost the X-ray emission. Because if you use solar wind ions, there are problems with both interpretations. Solar wind ions, you have already the high charge states of like carbon that are required to produce charge exchange, but the flux is low. And so you have to boost up the flux of these ions precipitating, and the way to do it is to accelerate them, so enlarging the loss cone, and you need something like 200 kilovolts on the planet to do that. In the case of magnetospheric ions, they are coming with, are originating with low charge states like sulfur or oxygen 2 plus or so. And so you need to strip them, and then they can produce charge exchange and X-rays. And to do that, you need some much higher voltages, like megavolts. One problem is that if you accelerate the ions, you accelerate protons as well in the solar wind, you would expect a bright proton aurora, which is not observed. And on the other hand, if you consider magnetospheric scenario, so you see why the magnetospheric origin is preferred, you could consider the bouncing motion of particles in the magnetic field. They could go at 45-minute periodicity, so that would be a nice way to explain that. On the other hand, Bunce and collaborators, just a year later, took a different approach and considered the processes that go on already on that are known to happen on Jupiter. In particular, if the emission is associated to the region where there is highest density, like the cusps, then she suggested that the acceleration that could come from reconnection. In particular, the connection of magnetic field, in particular the dayside and pulsed reconnection that would generate these 45-minute pulsations. And in that case as well, there would be acceleration enough to make the magnetospheric ions as a feasible origin of the charge exchange. And now to come to XMM. Now here you see spectral maps in narrow energy bands of the planet. And by now it was already clear that we should concentrate on charge exchange. So they are maps in oxygen 7 and oxygen 8, narrow energy bands. And you see that the planet is very bright in the aurora. And there is also, as expected, and there is also diffuse emission from the disk. This is an additional emission from the planet that I have ignored so far because we want to talk about charge exchange, but this emission is actually scattered solar X-rays by the atmosphere of the planet. So the planet, and the same for Saturn, act as a mirror of solar X-rays just as it does for optical light. And this varies with the variability of the solar X-rays. Like when there is a flare, Jupiter responds with a flare, and especially the equatorial regions, of course. If we go to higher energies, 3 to 5 kV, 5 to 10 kV, we don't see charge exchange lines anymore. What we see are still bright, the aurora. But this is a different component. This is bremsstrahlung. This is electron bremsstrahlung, featureless continuum. And we see that when we extract all the spectra very carefully for the different regions. Here we have the north in black and the south in red aurora. And you see that the spectra peak very strongly on this oxygen 7 line by charge exchange. In green is the disk coronal spectrum. The spectrum of this is again a thermal, optically thin spectrum like the solar corona. And so it's got lines as well, but it's pushed at higher energy, so it's distinguishable from the aurora. And then there is Electrum-Bremsstrahlung, the featureless continuum at the high energies. Now you see why the Electrum-Bremsstrahlung wouldn't work when people suggested it back in the Einstein time, because if you sort of consider its spectrum, it's like two orders of magnitude below the charge exchange. The charge exchange in the aurora really dominates. But it's actually quite interesting that during these observations, it was two observations in 2003 in the autumn, we saw this Electron-Bremsstrahlung, the shape and intensity of the radiation, change dramatically between the two observations. Now, this was a time when the Halloween, so-called Halloween storm in the solar wind was taking place. And more or less, if you propagate that phenomenon to Jupiter, its arrival coincided with the time of this observation. So it is possible that the solar wind has an impact, in fact, on the X-ray aurora. These are RGS data taken at the same time, and so as Conran described, this is as little as spectrometer, and you have wavelength and cross dispersion. So in practice, you get a picture of the planet as well in the cross dispersion direction and in wavelength in terms of different images in different energies or wavelengths. So here we have the position of oxygen 7, oxygen 8, the charge exchange lines, and that's iron 17, typical of solar spectra. And the two red lines represent the expected location of the aurora in that picture. And you see that in oxygen 7, we can actually spatially see the blobs that correspond to the emission of the aurora. Oxygen 8 is slightly extended as well, and that's auroral line as well, while iron 17 tend to be more concentrated in the disk because that's where they are coming from. And when you extract the spectrum from there, that's what you get. Unfortunately, it doesn't extend to like the region where we can expect carbon or sulfur lines, so there is no way of separating those. There is no sensitivity, unfortunately, for this object even with XMM. What we find is that the lines, the oxygen 8, oxygen 7 lines, are not narrow, but they have extended, broadened components. And in practice, they correspond to velocities of the particles emitting these X-rays of the order of 5,000 kilometers per second, which correspond to energies of the ions of the order of MeVs. So that ties in with what the models say, that you need to accelerate these particles in order to produce the charge exchange anyway, whatever they are and wherever they come from, within the system of Jupiter. And this is a look to the future, what Athena and the XIFU could actually produce. And that's where we will be able really to separate the lines that I was talking about, carbon, sulfur. This is a simulation, of course, taking into account the flux that we see in this range in the XMM spectra. So the extended wavelength range will help in that way. Athena, in the XIFU, will have something like two orders of magnitude higher effective area than the RGS. So we will be able to do like in a tenth of the time that the RGS took to take that spectrum, we'll get a much better spectrum already. And it's non-dispersive spectroscopy, it's a calorimeter, so we'll be able to map with this energy resolution the various parts of the planet. And also, the other sort of interesting thing is that by the time Athena will fly, Juice will be very close to Jupiter. You know, this is the big first big mission of ESA to Jupiter. And so we'll have a way of actually determining the conditions of the solar wind in situ directly. So it will be a good match. Or otherwise, if Chandra and XMM are still working, then we can use Juice. Wishful thinking. All right. So there was another interesting thing, somewhat related to the charge exchange business in the Jantra showed, and that is that with the ACES spectrometer, we actually noticed that different spatial morphology of the soft X-rays, the charge exchange X-rays, which are represented here by the small dots, or the small green dots. So, and they represent the hot spot that I was talking about before. And you see, they are all within the very large spots, which are the hard X-ray events above 2 kV, and which are due to the electron bremsstrahlung. So that was the first notice, that the there is a different morphology depending on energy. And then what you see here in orange is the bright oval, UV oval, as observed at the same time by the Hubble STIS imaging spectrometer. And what we see is that the hard X-ray events in practice coincide spatially with bright features and the oval, the FUV oval. Now, the interesting thing is that UV comes from excitation of the atmospheric hydrogen by electrons of between 10 and 100 kV. And the hard X-rays we see, the bremsstrahlung, has a temperature that can be of some few tens of kV. It's hard to determine with the spectrum we have, but it's certainly above 10 kV. So we see that there is a likelihood that the same energetic electrons are actually providing these hard X-rays as well as the UV. And the charge exchange events are all contained inside. Now, that leads me to talk about some recent work that my PhD student, Will Dunn, has been doing on some 2011 observations of Jupiter. Now, in this case, because still of this idea I had in the back of my mind that there may be some contribution from the solar wind, we organized observations of Jupiter coincident with the arrival of a CME, or a strong shock, at the planet. How did we predict that? Well, we used the M-SWIM propagations using measurements of the solar wind at 1 AU propagated to the planet. It's got quite a lot of uncertainty in this work, maybe one day uncertainty in the time of arrival. But for that reason, we asked for target of opportunity observations with Chandra, two of them separated by a couple of days, to see if we saw any differences. And we decided to go for the arrival of this particular strong shock. Now, what you see here are polar projections of the data we got. These are snapshots of only 50 minutes within the 11 hour of observations we had during the first and the second observation, separated by a couple of days. So it's 50 minutes of data. What you see here are polar projections in so-called System 3 reference for Jupiter, which is practically a geographical latitude-longitude system of reference fixed on the planet. And various colored dots correspond to individual events in the soft X-rays, and then gray ones that are mostly spread around the disk are the solar ones, and green, very few, are the bremsstrahlung. But anyway, what I want to point out is that these colored contours represent the magnetic field footprints of the most recent model updated of the magnetic field on Jupiter. The red contours represent closed field lines, so those that then close down to the other hemisphere. And the green ones, which are dotted, represent field lines which are open in some parts of them to the solar wind. Now, what we find is that, and look, the red arrow represents the direction of the sun for each of these observations. And it turns out that we always find the concentration of the hot spot of the soft X-rays coincident with open regions of those magnetic field lines. This is for a particular position of the sun. We have another one a little later on, and again you see the dots are always there, and then again over here, again the events fall over there. Now, this is work in progress, but it's suggestive that there is some connection with the solar wind, which is possibly coming down, you know, along these open field lines. So there may be a contribution of the solar wind. It's left to establish how much and when and why. And this brings me to this slide, which is to remind you, the fact that there is also flying a Japanese satellite called Hisaki, which is taking UV spectra of the planets and concentrated on Jupiter for about 6 months last year, taking spectra simultaneously of the aurora and of the Io plasma torus. The scope of this is to study the energy transport, the momentum transport, the mass transport between Io and the planet. And simultaneously with all this data obtained by Isaki, there has been a very large campaign of optical with HST and UV, Gemini optical from the ground, Chandra, XMM, Newton. This is a lot of work that is still in progress. Ralph Kraft is involved in this. I am involved in it. So there is lots of potential to get more and more results on the study of Jupiter. So that's where we are. Now, I'm quickly moving on to the other planets, because then I want to come back home to Earth. Saturn, as I said, in the case of Saturn, we don't have evidence for X-ray by charge exchange. In practice, the emission from the disk and the polar caps has the same spectrum, which is a solar corona spectrum, and the emission varies very much simultaneously with the behavior of the sun. In this case, during an observation, the sun gave a flare, and Saturn, once we correct for the time travel distance, we find that it's coincident. There is a little flare on Saturn as well. And on long term, like over years of observations, there is a strict correlation between the emission of X-ray power from Saturn. And this case is the solar 10.7 centimeter index, which is a proxy for solar activity. And as a curiosity, there is also emission from the rings of Saturn, probably scattered solar radiation. So as far as we can see, there is no charge exchange taking place, and particularly there is no auroral specific emission. Could be because the accelerating potentials are not high enough as they are in Jupiter, or that there isn't enough material to actually do this precipitation. There isn't a Io there that produces so much stuff. We don't know. We tried the same game as with Jupiter of looking at the time of the arrival of a CME or a strong shock. We did not find any enhancement. We actually saw an enhancement in the first observation with respect to the fire again. So, I couldn't stop myself to show this. You have already seen this part from Conrad, the overall spectrum from Mars, but you can break it down in the parts as I described. You can do some spatial resolution with the RGS, and you can take the part of the disk and the parts outside of the exosphere, and you get, as Conrad has shown very clearly in his paper in 2006, two completely different spectra. From the disk, you see fluorescence, again, scattering of solar X-rays from the atmosphere, the CO2 atmosphere of the planet. If you take the exosphere, this very extended corona, you find a charge exchange spectrum. And I think this is fascinating because also it shows the potential of RGS in separating this very interesting spectrum. Now we can get to the Earth. Now, Earth Aurorae, we don't know if there is charge exchange or not in them. The early observations were all at high energy, more than 2 keV, and that's where bremsstrahlung was found, like in these images from Pixie on Polar. And the spectrum of the X-rays implies a spectrum of the electrons producing the bremsstrahlung, which matches very well the UV emission as well. So that's all consistent. In the soft X-rays, Chandra has looked at the Earth aurora, finding that is very variable. There are big arcs and plumes forming and disappearing. Very interesting, but it didn't get a spectrum because the ACE's observations were considered too dangerous for various reasons, and so they were done with the high-resolution camera with no energy resolution. And it was only by comparison with some electron measurements from the MSP that Anil Barjah derived that probably the spectrum is bremsstrahlung plus some line emission excitation of nitrogen and oxygen. What we suggested we could do in order to check what the spectrum at soft X-rays is of the aurora was to propose for a CubeSat mission, a 3-unit CubeSat with an X-ray camera, a pinhole camera, and a tiny CCD, associating it with a miniaturized analyzer of particles and a magnetometer to do sort of measurements of the in-situ particles. It was a proposal that didn't get through, and in fact, the DXL Cupid suggestion that was put forward yesterday with to use lobster type optics on a similar 3-unit CubeSat. It's a great idea to try and do that, and in particular, looking at the aurora, it would be nice to know if there is any charge exchange taking place there or not, considering that the solar wind definitely has impact on the geospace. And then my last topic is what has been already covered very much yesterday, and that is the Earth's geocorona and the impact of the solar wind on it. We have already heard of the long-term enhancement of the quarter kV background that was seen in the Rosator Sky Survey. Similar results of correlation of X-ray emission, especially soft X-ray background lines with solar wind activity, is coming also from time variable oxygen emission lines that were observed on the dark side of the moon. Suzaku observations of the North Ecliptic Pole also showed an increase in soft X-ray lines correlated with solar wind proton flux, and then the systematic study of Jenny Carter with XMM Newton seemed to suggest all together that there is indeed, seemed to suggest, is pretty clear that there is increased variability of the soft X-ray background in terms of emission lines with solar wind activity. So the point is that SWX, solar wind charge exchange, is expected to produce a large increase in the X-ray line flux during solar wind storms. And so that brings in the idea that we could use these X-rays to image the boundaries of the Earth's dayside magnetosphere. Now, that can be done by another means as well, which is still related to charge exchange, and that would be energetic neutral atoms. But what we have learned already, for instance, from IBEX, is that it takes hours to actually get an image of these boundaries, which is sensitive enough for us to see exactly where the boundary is and so on. What X-rays can give us is the temporal resolution, which is comparable with the timescales of the interactions that we are interested in, a interactions of the solar wind with the magnetosphere. And they vary from a few minutes to an hour or so. And if we can do this kind of studies, they will be, first of all, help a lot in validating all the models that have been created of the Earth geospace, the Earth magnetosphere, on the basis of localized in-situ measurements done by other spacecraft. And then we will reach a much better understanding of how the Earth responds to the impact of the solar wind, so what we call the space weather. And then may help to tell us how to mitigate the effects that it has on the Earth infrastructure, which is a rather important problem at the moment. And then perhaps, who knows, one day to even forecast what can happen. Now, this is not a new idea. There have been earlier suggestions or proposals, for instance, of missions like MAGEX and STORM. We have been, in fact, with many people involved already in these earlier mission proposals. We have put forward originally in 2010 the idea of AXIOM, the Advanced X-ray Imaging of the Magnetosphere. And that was a medium-sized mission that we proposed to the European Space Agency. Didn't get through. I mean, it's early times, so you have to keep pushing. One day you'll get there. And so 2 years later, we proposed AXIOM again in a different incarnation, as called AXIOM C, to study the cusps in particular, because that's a region of high density where you expect a lot of X-rays. And in fact, you see here some of the simulations that were made in advance of these proposals, indicating where, for instance, in the cusps, it would be very bright, this emission. So AXIOM C didn't get through either. And so now we are the same kind of collaboration involving lots of different institutions, and now China as well. We are now proposing a new incarnation of AXIOM called SMILE, the Solar Wind Magnetosphere Ionosphere Link Explorer. And that is in response to an announcement of opportunity provided by ESA and CAS, the Chinese Academy of Sciences, for a joint mission with China. And just about a month ago, we put in the proposal, so it's being reviewed at the moment. The objective here is a bit forward with respect to AXIOM, because we really want to look at the link between the solar wind impact on the magnetosphere, the magnetopoles, bow shock, the cusps, but also linking it with the ultimate effects on the Earth ionosphere and the aurora. And so to do this, we have a vantage point that needs to be well outside of a magnetosphere, or as outside as possible. And we have chosen an elliptical orbit with 20 Earth radii apogee, 63 degree inclination, a sort of Molinier orbit, but not quite, because it precesses during the year, so that we can have different point of views of the magnetosphere. And that orbit maximizes as far as we can the viewing efficiency and the scientific return. The payload carries is made up of a soft X-ray imager, the SXI. So this is the main payload, the core instrument that measures the X-ray images. A UV imager as well for the aurora, so that the same time as we measure the X-rays produced in the magnetosheets, in the cusps, we actually see what happens to the aurora. We follow this link from the solar wind down to the poles of the Earth. And then we have also some light ion analyzer and a magnetometer, so that we know the conditions of the solar wind at the time of our observations. And in particular, the telescope is a lobster type, low mass, slumped MCP optic, very large field of view, good effective area, so we have a large grasp on the magnetosheath in particular. Good point spread function, 4.5 minute full width and maximum, that is very adequate for what we want. And the CCD detector, so that we actually measure the spectrum and we can match the ions that we see in the spectrum with the particle and what comes in from the solar wind. Now, hopefully this will work. This is a simulation that one of our Chinese collaborator, Tianran San, has produced on the basis of, let's hope it works. It fails me. No, it doesn't. Okay, great. What you see over, well, about a month ago, there was a great display of auroral. Have you seen it? Has anybody seen it? In the northern part of even the UK. And what happened then, so there was a big storm came in with the solar wind. These are the ACE data that were collected at the time and represents like the magnetic field, the density and speed of the solar wind and so on. And what you see on the right is the X-ray emissivity. Now, I don't know if we can actually be lucky twice. Yes. And the X-ray emissivity predicted for the magnetosheath, the cusps, the magnetopause, the nose of the magnetopause, and sometimes you see also out here the bow shock. And so these are the kind of things that SMILE wants to look at, and in addition to that, then look at what happens on the aurora of the Earth as a consequence of this storm coming in. Those were emissivity, so X-ray flux simulations. What you see here are simulations of what the counts from the X-ray telescope would be, and these are deconvolved processed images. These are not for that particular storm, from an earlier one in 2012. And the difference between the top and the bottom images here are that what we would expect to see before the arrival of the shock that corresponded to that event and after the arrival. So you see that we can fairly well describe and see and reveal the morphology of the interaction and the brightening up of the various boundaries of the magnetosphere. This is for the same storm what happens when you have, which was observed in the in situ data at the time, when the interplanetary magnetic field turns from northward to southward, and in the southward direction, then you have a better likelihood of reconnection taking place, and so energization of the magnetosphere. So you see how it's brighter in this case, the emission, than in the before the turning of the magnetic field. And these are all 5 minutes integrations. So definitely we can match the time scale of the interactions that we want to study. That's my last concluding slide, and it's the look ahead, which I always like to finish with. We really have found Chandra, XMM, Newton together have shown how much potential there is in planetary X-ray astronomy, have established the response of the planets to the solar wind, including that of the Earth, and have really established the charge exchange as a process that provides diagnostic, a global way of diagnostic, not only in the case of planets, but also of all kinds of astrophysical plasmas, like we have seen, we have heard, interstellar medium, stellar winds, supernova remnants, galaxies, clusters of galaxies. In the planetary context, observations at times of when the solar activity is larger are likely to return the greatest science, and the future is bright with Athena coming. And the ultimate goal really would be to have X-ray observations in situ at the planets. Have satellites like JUICE carrying X-ray telescopes so that we would have more sensitivity and resolution, of course, and to make X-rays on par as other wavelengths like UV, that always we have UV telescopes going to the planets. Thanks a lot. very feasible. We did propose it, but you can do it, because now with lobster type, this kind of micropore channel plate optics, the main problem, which is the mass of the optics, is gone, I would say, and you have a decent spatial resolution of the order of arc minutes. Yeah, so it's very feasible. I can't remember the numbers, but 10 kilos or something. And yes, but we did propose it for JUICE, but you need to educate the communities, both communities, geophysicists and astronomers, that this is worth doing. And it's getting better after a few years.
Sulfur ions get almost immediately accelerated to the co-rotation velocity. So why aren't they more completely stripped?
Why they are not?
Why are they not?
Well, I don't know. My understanding is that you need these very high potentials in order to. That's what reading Tom's paper convinces me. But they diffuse out. I mean, well, as far as I understand, as far as I understand, they diffuse out in the order of over the order of weeks or months from the IPT, the Io Plasma Torus, to the outer magnetosphere, and then they need something in order to be accelerated back to fall on the aurora. On the poles, and that's where these field-aligned potentials are required. As far as I understand, they tend to go down in the tail, and so you need to bring them back.
Well, thank you.
Oops.
And let's make